Now, operationally, the HCO is organized into three distinct networks, six distinct networks, excuse me, which are designed to cover facets of inequality. And so these are described up here. One group is, Jim is one of the direct leaders of, is on early childhood interventions, and that focuses on the essential role that that investments, experiences in early childhood have on the entire life course, and hence by implication on intergenerational transmission of socioeconomic status. A second group on family inequality focuses on, unsurprisingly, families, and there the body of the research focuses on the nature of bargaining between spouses, the decisions that families make in terms of investments, and as well as issues of family formation and disillusion. And actually, and obviously, that's complementary to any arguments about early childhood investments, since the families are playing such a fundamental role. The third network, which Bert Singer is running, is on health inequality. That represents a standalone area of research for several reasons. One simply is an increasing understanding that when one talks about physical capital, human capital, social capital, or whatever capital you want to throw in, health capital is a fundamental aspect of any notion of individual well-being, as well as one of the mechanisms that explains the evolution other aspects of socioeconomic outcomes, such as education. Another aspect of that network is an interest in understanding the genetic role of genetics in socioeconomic outcomes, and that, you will not be surprised to hear, is an extraordinarily difficult question to make any constructive progress on. The fourth network, on identity and personality, really represents an effort to enrich the economic approach to inequality by taking ideas in psychology seriously. And so in that network, what you know as behavioral economics would be part of the work, but the work in fact is substantially broader, because it is actually focusing not on economists' efforts to understand deviations from some stereotypical notion of homo economicus and the associated rationality assumptions, but rather to ask what it is in the psychological approach to understanding decision making, to understand the influences on choices, et cetera, ought to be imported into the way we think about the determination both of choice and the implications of those choices for life course inequality. In addition to which, the notion of identity, which co-leader Rachel Cran and George Akerlof have developed, and Rachel will be lecturing on later this week, is very much focused on the issue of understanding how individuals make choices not to maximize the utility function, but because they have a certain conception of the person, quote unquote, they wish to be or that they ought to be, and the choices are therefore subsumed under the effort to fulfill that that identity. The fourth group is a little bit of a catch-all. It's you can see it sounds like it's everything: inequality measurement, interpretation, and policy. And Scott Commoners is a co-director with myself. Rob Duggar, who's with myself, as one of the two co-directors of HCO. Jim is the godfather, he's the director, and Richard Reeves of the Brookings Institution. And this network covers a number of distinct areas. One area is work Scott will talk about on market design, and it's basically asking how can one think of the design of markets itself as a policy object which has inequality implications. And so it moves away from this dichotomy of saying here are the markets, here's another set of things the government can do to redistribute, but rather say that the market structure in many contexts itself can be the object of a policy analysis. Another dimension of the network is complementary to the identity and personality, in the sense that it's focusing on sociological aspects of behavior and introducing those into what I'm going to call the canonical economic formalism. Larry Bloom will be lecturing tomorrow on social networks, which is a natural aspect of that. And there's obviously other dimensions along which the network is concerned in understanding, broadly speaking, the role of social factors in individual outcomes. And the final network is on markets, and that is the network that in some sense focuses on maybe the most neoclassical perspective on understanding inequality. But at the same time, it takes a particular, it's focusing very much on markets and their implications for human capital formation, in which complicated issues of credit constraints and the like arise. And so, there's the cliche about the blind man and the elephant. And I think it's a little bit more than that in the sense that these are different aspects of inequality, but the network itself as a collective, the working group itself as a collective intellectual enterprise is attempting to develop this this comprehensive view of inequality and address the questions such as with a plethora of very complex of explanations for the phenomena. How does one assess empirical salience? How does one engage in sensible policy advice given limits to knowledge and given the complexity, the high dimensionality of the phenomena under discussion? So, Jim, is there anything you wanted to add? Okay. Well, then I'm just going to turn the floor over. Again, you're all very welcome, and Jim Heckman.
Okay, so I'll join Steve in welcoming you here and trying to, I guess everybody has a copy of the program and the lectures, right? So we don't have to review any of that. What I want to talk about today, well, actually I'm giving two sets of lectures today. What I want to talk about this morning and kind of split the time with Steve is to lay the framework. I mean, inequality, as Steve said, and as is obvious, is a vast subject. And there have been a lot of studies done on inequality. And one of the biggest problems has been to kind of try to organize all of the thinking in inequality into some kind of conceptual framework or a series of frameworks that are at least related to each other. And I want to talk today about at least some of the main facts that we want to address throughout the week. But I won't explain, I won't do everything because it would be very tedious to do so. And I want to take only about an hour, a little bit more maybe, to review the main facts. These slides would be available. You should be able to access them right now from the network you've got. And also you could print them, although I'm not sure exactly what the facilities are for printing. We have these. All the slides that are used by all the speakers are more or less in the public domain. In fact, these are videotapes, so if you waited a few days, you could actually watch it on the internet, or at least on a DVD that we'd provide. So let me talk, and let me just say that I would very much appreciate clarifying questions, and even comments and disagreements on the nature of the my characterization of the evidence. But let me just start and go through a guided tour. There are 11 main points, and there are lots of details within each of these points. But I want to just at least summarize the way the literature has proceeded in discussing inequality and the different dimensions and how important they are empirically. And here I'm going to put together a body of evidence from various reports, some of it my own research, some of it with people in this room, actually, to try to sort of lay out certain perspectives and different aspects of the question. What is it we're trying to study? What is it we're trying to understand? And it's a very interesting topic, made more interesting because people reach starkly different conclusions. And I'll try to show you why that might be. So let me just start. So these are the main 11 topics. The most common interest is, of course, in earnings and household income. But household income, of course, brings together many different factors that are actually represented in the HCEO enterprise. It includes not only the earnings of the individuals at an individual basis, but includes things like the pooling of the earnings to come up with consumption or welfare transfers within the household. It would also consist of matters about who marries whom, who sorts with whom, and also it would involve things like whether or not people are choosing to marry at all, so single versus married households and cohabiting households. So the household is a major unit and of enterprise, but it brings together, even the analysis of household income inequality brings together many different aspects of HCEO's mission. And so I want to talk not only about the definitions that people use, but also in terms of the income inequality, how it's evolved over OECD countries. But commonly, and this is more true of the labor economics literature than of the general inequality literature, people have looked at the distribution of hourly wage rates, not only at a point in time, but over time. And there are some challenges that arise that in doing that, just interpreting what exactly these hourly wages mean. Are the hourly wages so measured prices is the main question. And if so, and if not, what are they? I would also point out that there's a serious issue, which has received a lot of literature discussion in terms of the economics of education and the labor economics literature, which has been the what many people view, at least in the American context, it's not a universal phenomenon, is a fairly sluggish response of education, educational attainment to rising wage differentials, which would actually be associated with high rates of return or high economic benefits. And I want to consider not only the wages, so I want to consider that in the strictly American context, and then I want to go to the international context. And also another dimension, obviously, about inequality is how, whether or not people are working in the market. And if they're not, why so? And how much does this variation in supply of work, supply of labor, affect the inequality that individuals are experiencing? And then, of course, an important dimension that's featured very much in the current discussion around the world is the role of the state in terms of redistribution in the view of transfers, in the view of subsidies to various individuals. And how much of inequality that we see across countries in terms of net incomes is a result of very substantial differences in tax and transfer policy. And there I will show you some startling statistics. Now, of course, if we look at income, most people are interested in some final measure of consumption or some final measure of welfare. And so consumption inequality is another aspect. And there, the literature is not as clear as it could be, or should be probably, one would like to have. Namely, that some of the discussion about whether or not there's rising inequality in consumption doesn't mirror the literature in the rising income inequality that's been claimed or been found by many different scholars. And the question is, what's going on there, and what's the standard of living? How is that changing for the bottom 10% of the income distribution, for the median, for the overall, so welfare comparison, but also dispersions and other measures of dispersion? I don't want to poach on the territory of James Foster, who's going to talk about various measures of income and measuring income and consumption inequality. But nonetheless, it's a very serious issue, not only an empirical issue about lack of data, but also an issue about the structure of how we actually go from income to consumption, and then an even more inclusive measure of well-being. And then we already talked about the family. We're going to talk a lot about the family this week. The family is a source of inequality through assortative mating, through formation, pooling of units. And a huge difference here is going to be how much is the family unit contributing to inequality? How much are trends in families contributing to inequality, not just in the United States, but around the world? Now, another dimension that's sometimes treated separately, although we want to really integrate this into our thinking, is health inequality. How much inequality around the world is actually how different in different dimensions of health, life expectancy, how much in terms of infant mortality and so forth. What are the relationships between income inequality and health inequality, and of course the level of health and the level of income? And finally, and not because of any disinterest, but the data are typically, except for OECD countries like Mexico and Chile, that receive a lot of scrutiny because they're in the OECD database and collect statistics, the data from developing countries is skimpier, but it's important to look at patterns. I don't know how many of you have followed the recent discussion in the New York Times and The Economist, Amartya Sen, Prana Bharatan today, actually in the New York Times, is attacking sin. Sin is, of course, talking about inequality and economic development. And Bharatan is taking him to task, as did Bhagwati over the weekend in The Economist, saying, well, you know, redistribution is not really so important for economic development. So I want to talk briefly about these issues. Recently, Steve Durloff and I were in China running a similar workshop, and we participated in active discussions where people are worried, justly so, about the rising inequality in China, in the sense that the Gini coefficient is high and rising, and there's a lot of inequality between the North and the South, and the East and the West especially, and so in rural areas. But the question really becomes, well, what's the true measure of inequality that we're interested in the sense of looking at second-order stochastic dominance? You can really see that the Chinese have moved substantially in terms of having economic development, so that the poorest person in China today is much, much better than the poorest person was in 1980. And the question is, what exactly can we say about measures of inequality, and what are the trends in developing countries? Okay, so much for the overview. Let me just talk about the different units that people look at. And here, this is the helicopter tour of inequality measurement. But of course, the household level is a serious issue and is made, most of the statistics are presented, not all, not just in the labor economics literature, but in the popular literature, the 99 versus the 1. So a distinction is made among these different marital statuses, single-headed, married, and cohabiting households, with some of which could really be single-headed, but nonetheless, there is a sense of maybe some more pooling of resources, an understudied topic, but really quite important. And then the question is, how do families respond to the children? How do they respond to the, say, a shock, a health shock? Gabriella and I have a paper with some others where we actually look at how when families receive a health shock to one child, they compensate or reinforce across other siblings. So there's a lot of action going on, just transferring, not just between husband and wife in terms of standard sharing models, of which you'll hear a lot when Pierre Andre lectures, but also in terms of just child development and compensation reinforcement. And of course, the transfers between the parents and the child, a big transition underway about the extent of family support of parents. Which was a traditional value, certainly in East Asia, and is now dampening in the face of growing welfare state policies. And then, of course, there's transfers across extended families where individuals. So all of these are dimensions which could really warrant separate lectures, but there are going to be parts of what we hear. There's also a very important distinction which shows up in the literature. It's an old distinction, but one that one continuously gets neglected, especially in the popular literature. Namely, inequality at a point in time, and I mean, say, in 1980 for a person, say, 35, groups of people, say, 30 to 35 years of age, looking at not only what the dynamics would be in the individual at a point in time, but how much inequality changes over the life cycle. So we know from basic human capital theory that wages grow with age, or with work experience. More educated people typically have a profile of lower wages initially, going to school and then receiving higher wages later. So life cycle dynamics plays a very important role in understanding the measurements. It also plays a very important role in understanding the nature of credit constraints that families are facing and how that affects their behavior, not only towards the sharing within husband and wife, but also the investment in children. And also, we would want to consider, when I say time, I really mean age, but sometimes these two are confused, how whole cohorts are changing and how different populations or different cohorts are weighted. So for example, in China, we're seeing a population that's getting very old very fast, and that by itself has real implications for what the aggregate income inequality is. We also want to consider, in the sense of life cycle, how attributes, productive attributes, which you're going to call capabilities, investment dynamics, including this notion about identity formation, how these dynamics are actually evolving and what exactly is causing. So we think of schooling, we think of human capital. We want to think of a more inclusive notion of what skills and productive attributes are. And we want to consider this in a life cycle setting. Most skills are acquired. There's this claim that's out there, probably an urban legend or at least a statement about after 10,000 hours of doing anything, you're a real expert at it. I'm not sure that's true, but nonetheless, that's thought. But you do see payoffs from experience, and you do see that to become a professional, and it takes a while, and it pays off, and it leads to an earnings dynamics and also a consumption dynamics. And then consumption, coming back to consumption. The individual consumption, embedded in the family, maybe, but also just thinking of it on the single life cycle agent of the individual, consumption's thought to be a better measure of welfare, but this depends critically on the market structure. So we really have to understand how exactly markets are working. How well can we borrow against future income? And if we can't, what kind of implications does it have for inequality? So then another whole dimension of the study of inequality is understanding how well markets are working, in this case, credit markets, how well people can borrow and lend. Okay. So we want to talk about things like wages, attributes. I'm going to come up with this notion and refine the notion of functionings. It's a notion that builds off of some work by Amartya Sen and Martha Nussbaum, but particularly Sen on capabilities. But it's really your capacity to act in the wider world. And I want to consider then capital, income, wealth, consumption, and health. Okay. And Steve has already talked about these things, about intergenerational transmission. Not just life cycle inequality, but how families pass on their environments, their advantages across generations. This is an area that's undergoing tremendous rethinking, as we've learned a lot more about genetics and what's called epigenetics, how genes expression, gene expression is modified by environments and particular parental, peer, and other environments. So we want to consider both the measurement and modeling issues. But here, just to put out the common, this is almost trite now, but it's important to talk about it, because everybody talks about inequality in a different way. Some people see it as a good, some people see it as a bad. And so the boilerplate simplistic assessment about the two faces of inequality are really the notion, well, okay, look, we're getting unequal wages, we're maybe getting unequal prices, but that could be because there's a scarcity out there. And if we really have a functioning supply, then it's a market signal and that actually produces. It rewards ability, it rewards people who are actually making investments. So that's the notion of good inequality. But of course, there's also a negative face to inequality, which is a so-called bad inequality that arises from discrimination and denial of opportunity. And so these two themes are going to show up repeatedly throughout the course. People are going to be asking, well, you know, gee, this is an incentive. Why didn't the incentive work better? We see that the price of more educated labor has gone up. But somehow, at least in the United States, the response seems to be weak. But there still is a sense there is a value in the market signal. But then you could argue no, because of a number of reasons, say because of race, because of religion, because of credit markets. Individuals may be differentially able to take advantage of the signal that's sent by the market. And then we think of that as somehow inequality of opportunity. And Steve's going to talk a lot about that. So let me just talk about a couple of themes that are going to run through my lectures and will run through, I think, some other lectures as well, but I can only speak for myself. Namely, what I want to think about is what I call capabilities, or what Sen really called capabilities, but my interpretation of this. Namely, I want to think about trying to look at the skills of individuals, but skills in a broad sense. It's really the capacities to function. And I want to consider then these notions. Now, Sen and Nussbaum and their works, I have a series of books, papers, and so forth, that are talking about aspects of things like political inclusion, freedom of the press, political liberties. I'm not going to go so far. I'm thinking about skills to act in life, so how well one can manage oneself, how well one can manage one's health, how well can one manage one's portfolio, and make choices, and how many choices are open to you as a result of the basic skill set that you possess. So a synonym with what I'm using, the way I'm using capabilities, is in terms of skills. And so this is going to be a notation I'm going to use this afternoon. But we want to think that agents have really a vector of capabilities, cognitive, social-emotional skills, and health vectors that actually create outcomes. And just to anticipate, what I'm going to say is that we're going to talk about this dynamically with a theta at a given age, the capacities one has, how those are affected by various kinds of interventions and environments, and then, of course, how these express themselves in a number of different attributes. This is at least my way of attempting to try to unify what is a very daunting literature. But immediately you can see that if we start looking at inequality, this is only a subset of the story. I already talked about political inequality. Here, let me go back one slide to this point by Sin and Nussbaum, that there are many different other aspects of inequality. And there are also aspects of inequality that have to do with things like the not just the skill set, but how the prices of those skills would be determined, the amount of uncertainty that's out there in the society. And I'll talk about it, but some of the other lectures will actually talk more about it. So, of course, we have then how markets are responding, how much uncertainty, how much fundamental uncertainty has happened, and what kind of shocks individuals face. And even the distribution they draw from could be a function of their capabilities. So there are many, many aspects of this subject. Okay, so that's the overview. Let me just talk very briefly. Well, let me talk. I don't know if it's briefly, but we have a lot of slides about inequality and just some definitions. This is looks very boring, but it's actually pretty essential. So, for example, here's an example of what we mean by things like earnings. You've probably all seen a version of this. It's on the slides. But if you look at individual income, it has earnings, and that's kind of received a lot of attention. But there are also all these other components. Now I'm taking an American perspective, but we can see that there's a lot of variation. There are things like, what we think of as pension payments, transfers, and things like income from capital, educational assistance, child support, and other kinds of income, business income, professional income, and the like. So these are the dimensions we want to consider. And again, you can read this for yourself. I needn't read it for you. But I think money, wage, and income is already raises a series of issues that are due, actually, talking about how much you get paid for your actual employment. And of course, with self-employment, you get into issues which are addressed frequently in the literature, and that has to do with the structure of goods and services that people would, entrepreneurs, small businesses would affect. And it also affects your tax status later. So net income from salary income, that's more traditional, big chunk of modern income. But self-employment is not a trivial component. And in less developed countries, really quite important, especially farm self-employment. So we wanted some kind of net concept that after you put in your inputs, after you buy goods from the market, what's left over to you as your income? And that's what these measures are about. Now, the household income, what is a household? A household is going to consist of individuals, at least in the United States measures, who are income of everybody over 15 years of age, whether or not they're related to the household. So a household is a reporting unit. It's not what we think of as a family unit in the simplest, purest sense. And that can lead to some substantial differences. Another distinction we can see when we look at Piketty and Saez and some of the debates about their findings is whether or not we have a taxpayer unit as assembled by them in their studies versus a household unit, which is basically what the CPS and a lot of the current statistics are thinking. And then, of course, there is a non-trivial issue about how we adjust for things like, let me take the second point first. Household size. Here, the CBO and its adjustments will frequently look at things like the square root of household size to get at some idea of adjustments for economies of scale. There's a whole literature on equivalent scales and how we actually deflate and what household production is, what the real income is of the unit. But a more mundane issue, which has real consequences for understanding inequality, though, is how do we adjust for the quality of goods that people are buying? And there's this big literature recently on the Walmart effect, namely showing that individuals at the bottom of the distribution, whose nominally of the wage distribution, whose nominal wages have actually declined, if we look closely at what the price of the goods is that they're buying in real wage terms, that may not be true. And I'll show you some of the evidence on that. So these matters are mundane, but important. Mundane may be too strong. They're actually all research areas. And then we want to consider these, and I'm just looking at CBO data because I'm going to show you some CBO data. So market income plus government transfers makes a big difference, and then government transfers minus federal taxes, because taxes are playing a very strong redistributional role. So here's the definition of household market income. I'll let you study that, transfer income and the like. Okay, so let me show you the first set of statistics. I think most of you have seen this, but this is why there were riots in Wall Street a few years ago. This is why there's a lot of discussion. There's no joking here. If you look at after-tax household income, you see that there's been a substantial growth of the top 1%. 1% of the household. There's this is not a figment of some cell meeting in the basement of Greenwich Village or something. This is a real thing, and it's quite dramatic. And it's more dramatic, actually, in the United States than it is in other countries. There's been other growth as well. But here, we've already taken the position of looking at quantiles of the distribution. I'll come back to that. Why do we want to look at quantiles? A lot of people do. It's convenient. It's very convenient. Trouble is the zeros are floating around in that distribution, and there are a couple of issues about how the composition changes. But if we look, for example, this is again now looking at the U.S. Context. And Steve, you can stop me at any point, because I'm on page 3 of a 3,000-page handout, so. Not really, but it's pretty big. And
what you meant was I can try to stop you at any point.
No, you can actually stop me. I'm actually easily stopped. But what we can see is these are like Lorentz curves. You can see where the perfect line of equality, the 45-degree line, you've seen this before. And as we bow away from that line, we're getting more unequal. And we can see that if you look at labor income, just comparing the late 70s to 2007, so this is pre-latest recession, depression, whatever you want to call it, meltdown, we can still see growing income inequality. We can see a concentration of business income, income from business establishments, capital income, excluding capital gains, and then you can see that capital gains income was always heavily concentrated, but became more so over this period. So in many different dimensions, we're seeing rising inequality. Again, this is at the household level. Now, this is the famous graph, one of them, a series. I'll show you a few by Piketty and Saez. And they update this graph. You can go to their website. This is in their Quarterly Journal of Economics article 2004. But what they did here, it was very interesting. They looked at data from the Internal Revenue Service and other sources, Social Security Administration, this is IRS data, and they were actually able to see what share of total income, this is including and excluding capital gains, going back to 1917, what fraction of the total of the top decile income share of the total income is shared by the is taken by the top 10%, and you can see that going back to the 1920s. The so-called gay 20s or the roaring 20s, you can see that there was a large share taken back even into the 30s, a decline during the Second World War, and recent times in, say, by the time we get into the 2000s, we start seeing we're back to exactly the level we were at, say, in the 1920s and 1930s. So there has been, by this measure, growth, and it gets refined. Here we can actually, they can go not just to the top 10%, but they can look at the share of income held by individuals at the top 1%, top 5%. So we can see a real concentration. And the measures here in dollars, I think 2008 dollars, you can see then that the top 1% is people above $368,000 in 2008. Again, household income, you're seeing a huge growth, and that's a factor which has to be explained, and why, what are the factors giving rise to that? And now we look at the top 0.1%, we see a huge growth as well. And we're, so by many measures, we're finding ourselves as a society, at least the United States, much more unequal. But what's interesting, and they point out, and has been found in a lot of the literature, is that the composition of this income is changing. And just if you look closely at these figures, actually I'm too close, so I can't really see it, but what we can actually see is that that wage income is playing a role that's much greater than it was in the early years. In the 1920s, typically, you had the image of the capitalist clipping coupons from the bonds and so forth and getting capital gains. Well, there's some of that going on, of course, now, but you're also seeing us large salaries, high salaries, and salaries associated more with labor, and so with a labor component of earnings. So that's an important dimension. And in fact, if we look at this, instead of looking at those graphs, which are not too easy to read, you can see what the composition is of the top 0.1%. It consists of individuals. Now, some of this is also capital income that they're getting, bonuses in the form of stock options and so forth. But you can see that there really are substantial fractions of people who are there in these occupations who are executives, managers, supervisors, and then financial professionals playing a big role. So it's really much more oriented. And here, this kind of says the same thing. I will not regale you too much further. Now, let me just consider the international perspective. Again, this is from Piketty and Saez. And how anomalous is the United States compared to the other countries? And so we can see, actually, that the United States, in terms of this graph, so they actually have comparable statistics over the period, over this period, 1913 to 2007. And you can see the United States here. I actually even have a pointer that this graph here, this curve here, is showing that this run-up, well, it's occurring in other countries as well, United Kingdom, to a much lesser extent in France, but certainly substantial when it comes to the United States. So you're seeing a substantial run-up in the structure of the of inequality. And so it's not a universal phenomena. What's universal is, of course, the tendency towards increasing inequality. But the sharp run-up at the top 1% is much steeper in the United States. And this is giving you some more statistics on the other thing. So let me show you, just generally speaking, about inequality across Europe, across the OECD, actually. And so this would include countries that report to the OECD, Mexico, Israel, as well as in Japan, and Western European countries and North American countries besides Mexico. And so we can see that the general pattern has been that the Gini coefficient, which is a standard measure, has been increasing in other countries, although the extent, the levels are different, obviously, and the extent of the increase is different across different countries. We also see countries up until at least the late 2000s, like France, Hungary, and Belgium, where there really was very little change in inequality, and then decreasing inequality, although it's unfortunate that Greece is here. I would imagine that this is through 2007. This doesn't include the latest developments, so it has a problem. What's that?
Certain type of equality
down at the bottom, yeah, if everybody's starving at the same trough or something. Okay, this is a very, this. If I had to take one graph that was kind of very central to this course and where we're going to show with all this, is a graph taken again from the OECD report. And again, all the citations are given in the associated handout. But what this does is it basically talks about how much, this goes back to my laundry list of what's going on here, and how much of this rise in inequality, we can decompose the Gini coefficient into different components. And we can ask how much of this is due to things like earnings disparity of men. So we can see that like 42%, now these are decompositions, so we know sometimes they can be negative components, sometimes positive components. But if you look at this, you can see that about half of all the increase, the total increase, is actually going to be due to male earnings disparities. We can also see another chunk is men's employment. Another chunk, and here's where the household and demographic factors come in, we can see the household structure and the assortive mating are playing about 22%. So we do see a pattern where more educated men are marrying more educated women. But we also see, and that's a source of inequality, but we also see that there has been household structure changes. So we're getting a growth in single family households, and we're getting, as a consequence of that, some growth in inequality. So we're getting inequality, and each of these has a subtle story underneath it. This is, of course, the residual, which is non-trivial. But you'll notice that women's employment over here, this factor here, is actually an equalizing fact. So men's employment disequalizing, women's employment equalizing, a large growth in female employment. I'll show you some statistics. But here you can see now, and this is not to sort of take the thunder away from Pierre André or anything of the sort. He's going to be talking a lot about these two components of inequality. But you can see that the concern that's been out there in the literature looking at wages and the labor market is non-trivial, that it's there. You have the data, and it's there. It's explaining a big chunk of the story. The graph is a little asymmetric. It doesn't have a comparable figure for women's earnings disparity. We'll talk a little bit about that in a minute. But the fact is that this is the lion's still a driver, a major driver. So what's going on in the labor market is still playing a role. Although when you look at those very high income statistics that I just showed you from Piketty and Saez, you're going to end up with a very different story and saying, okay, there's labor market, but this isn't your man running a lathe or somebody actually selling hot dogs on the street. This is usually very different type of employment, labor, but it's still a form of labor earnings, as I just showed you. Okay, so this graph we want to return to throughout these sequences of lectures because it's really important, or at least I would keep it in mind. Now, this is also, though, to go on to show that inequality, as we measure it in terms of household net income and something like the disposable income individuals have, that the state and the transfers in the states are playing a very important role. So this, I think, is a very interesting and important graph. So we can look at what is the Gini coefficient of market income. This is pre-tax, pre-redistribution income. And you can see that across many different countries, many of them where we see stark differences in the Gini coefficient, that in terms of kind of the raw drivers of inequality, those are pretty uniform. I mean, they're not the same. I mean, it's clear that Mexico and Chile are high up there. The United States is relatively high. But you can see that there is a pretty, I'm sitting here in an angle. This is very biased here. So if you look here on the 45-degree line, countries that you don't think of as being that unequal because of their household income aren't. But it's because they're basically the disposable income, the tax transfer system. So the tax transfer system is playing a huge role. And it's understated, and it's actually changed over time. So it's another part of the political economy. And this is basically showing you how household income inequality, after you account for different measures. So the really sharp differences between the income after transfers and tax, the income inequality. And so the political economy here is playing a very substantial role in explaining household income. Okay, share of top incomes increasing, that's not too surprising. Let me just point out something you've probably seen a million times, and so I'll give you one more peek at it. This is the labor economics literature that goes back now many years, but looking at basically things like the skill premium, or so-called skill premium. This is looking at the high school, college, log weekly wage ratio. And what you see, of course, has been a run-up. And you've seen a run-up so that over the period 1980, roughly around this period here, you see that the return, so-called return, really the ratio of the college wage to the high school wage, for measured at the weekly level and adjusted for various kinds of factors like age and so forth, you've seen a real increase. And that's been documented in many countries, but not all. But certainly in the United States, it's a major phenomenon. And you can break it down. I'm not going to go through all of the details. But if you look at the differences in terms of the weekly wage changes of high school dropouts to high school graduates, over the period 63 to 2008, you see substantial decline in the wages of dropouts relative to high school graduates, which is one measure. And you also see the pattern is not uniform, though, across the two different gender groups. You can see there's been a substantial decline. The people say, well, a period of 1999-2008 wasn't so bad. Well, it wasn't so bad for men, but there was a substantial decline. This is now the ratio, the skill price. Sometimes it's a rate of return. It's not always a rate of return, not usually a rate of return. There's a big difference between the two. But nonetheless, you can see that the skill price has really declined for high school dropouts, and it's pretty severe for women and for men. Over this period of 1989-1999, substantial decline, relative. Now, of course, the absolute level of high school graduates could also be declining, and was over this period. This is another way to look at dropouts versus college graduates, and you get a dramatic story, which also tells you something about the differential movement of female college graduates versus male college graduates, but that's another story. But what you're actually seeing, though, is basically a real decline so being a high school graduate is not a good thing, relatively, and over some part of the time, absolutely. What we've also seen, and again, looking at ratio of earnings, male to female earnings, has been a steady increase, but nonetheless, stability around 77%. And these are full-time, year-round workers, and with various kinds of adjustments, you'll find substantial difference still between males and females, although within narrow occupations, not so bad. I'll show you some statistics in a second. So here is the kind of story that the labor economists dwell on and document very well. This is for males. This is the log weekly wages for full-time, full-year workers. And if you look at the high school dropouts, that's this bottom group here, and we index it on a base of zero, say, in 1963, that we actually see real wage declines. That actually, in terms of real wages, you're getting a decline. And that's adjusting for things like work experience and the aging of the population. You can also see dramatic rise in terms of individuals who have college degrees. And so this gap is real and has a counterpart. Now, if you do the same thing for females, you get a slightly different story, which is less of a decline story, but not very substantial growth. And the gaps, however, are substantial and widening. And these others are intermediate skill categories. High school graduates aren't really doing all that well, but they are holding in. And these are gender gaps. And these are now, and this is a common measure, which I want to I'm just asserting there's a paper by Asimoglu and Otter that's in the Handbook of Labor Economics. They have a lot of useful statistics there. I'm just drawing from that, but these are out in the public domain in a lot of papers. And what we see is huge run-up at the top of the distribution, and with a pattern that's fairly monotonic at the top. Stretches here, pulling males and females together, by the way. And then you can see starting to get an increase here in real wages in the middle periods, starting in the 90s to 2008. So there is, it's not a uniform story. And this is the story for men with this decline that I was mentioning earlier, and for women also. Now, one fact that's been come out a lot, at least people have talked about, Federal Reserve policy has looked at it, is whether there's polarization in the labor market. And the issue is really how much do we see in terms of wage change over these two different periods. So in the early period of studies here, now this is hourly earnings quantile. So this is looking at the distribution of hourly wages, constructing quantiles, and going across from the bottom to the top. So what is the bottom 5 percentile doing, say, over the period 74 to 88? It's suffering a real decline, okay? If we look at the same quantile over the period 88 to 2008, we actually see an increase, small increase. And so there's stories out there. Asimoglu and Otter have a particular story. It's a story of demand, really, for services and low-skilled workers as complements to high-skilled workers. And of course, a substantial run-up in the real wages of those at the very high end of the distribution. the story is much stronger for men, okay, than it is for women. They're this kind of, I mean, it's obviously it's not declining, but it looks like a fairly flat profile and then increasing over this. So at different stretches of the distribution, you're getting different patterns. Okay, so this is I put this in as a reference. I'll come back to it, but I don't need to really. So what I'll do is just look at the annual earnings of all workers over time and look at what the Gini coefficient is. And you could get back to my life cycle distinction. How much does inequality change if we somehow form averages? Now, again, some people would say the ideal average is some life cycle consumption profile average. And we're not going to get to that quite yet. But if you form five-year averages, which is what some people would call at least a measure of permanent income, at least it's a long-run income, you can see you reduce inequality somewhat. So there is substantial year-to-year variation. In fact, a very large literature, well summarized by Pistafari and McGeer in their Handbook of Labor Economics paper in 2011 about some of the earnings dynamics. This work goes back to Milton Friedman, actually, speaking. But we can actually see then that the inequality between all workers, so we are getting a reduction when we average, but there still is substantial inequality. And the important point is that the inequality is not transitory. It is staying. It's persisting. So even for five-year averages, we see the run-up is there in other measures of long-term income. And we can break this down into what are called permanent and transitory. Permanent would be like putting in an individual fixed effect or some common component. Transitory would be the deviation. There are various from that, which is assumed to be independently distributed across time, although not necessarily identically, and in fact it isn't identically. But we see that there's been a run-up in basically these permanent earnings, and the transitory earnings variation is much less substantial. So, but it's still the case that however we measure these things, three-year averages, five-year averages, you're getting a top 1% increase. You're getting a big share, big run-up in the share. And you're also getting something else. And again, this is from Piketty and Saez data with various co-authors, that what you're seeing is what's the probability of staying in the top one percentile of the family income distribution? Well, you can see that there's a very high probability of persistence after 1 year. It drops, as you might expect. You're getting shocks year by year. But still, after 5 years, there's a very strong persistence. It's not like rags to riches within a few years. There's a fairly strong persistence, which has a counterpart in terms of the estimated serial correlation coefficients on the residuals, on the earnings equations. Okay, now here is something that I think is important when we go back and ask, what's going on here? This is the first crack at looking at what the determinants are of what the earnings would be. And we can say, okay, look, the first thing that we understand is even though we have lots of papers talking about the role of education with work experience, education and its effect on wages and so forth. The important thing to understand is that when we look at the R squared, just how much of the variance in log hourly wages, this is NLSY data, what are we explaining? These are two different samples of NLSY. The story isn't vastly different, so let me just focus on this particular sample. So let me just look at these numbers, this gray column, and then the three numbers following it. This is looking at annual earnings, this is employment, and this is annual hours, and this is the hourly wage rate. So we think, well, how much of a variance do we actually explain by education? About 10%. I mean, it's important. We think about the total variability in the population. We're not explaining that much. How much do we explain by measures of cognition? Just alone, just by itself, cognition, about 10%. Okay, how much about measures of personality? About 7%. How much is work experience? And then we can take various combinations. We take all these things together, we explain about 20%, 80% unexplained. And what can the rest be? Well, if you look at the work by people like people who, for example, a lot of work on measurement error, at most maybe 20, 25% of the variance. So even in the most favorable to measurement error story, you're getting still well over half of the variance not being explained by most of the predictors that we commonly use. And I think that's important. And if you look at the other components of earnings, this is total earnings, which is wages times total hours worked. But what you're seeing is, again, quite, you know, here experience matters, but there's a little bit of a tautology there. Personality factors play a role. Cognition plays a role. But nobody, and in fact, I don't have the slide here. I could tell you tomorrow or this afternoon. I can just need to take a peek. But typically, the measure of cognition here is including an achievement test, and the achievement test actually explains better. These has a higher correlation than pure IQ, which would be closer to 0.04, 0.05. So what we're seeing is substantial, there is predictive power. These things are, quote, statistically significant, and yet there's a lot that we don't know. Now, what we haven't really done here is explain total, how much of this is random? How much uncertainty is there? I'm going to show you a statistic this afternoon that suggests from a number of different studies, not just my own studies with co-authors, but looking at about half of the variability of lifetime earnings is basically unpredictable by the factors that we have more or less in place or could forecast at age 18. So there's a lot of uncertainty out there, and that's kind of an important factor, although this table is not directly considering uncertainty. It's just saying, what do we get when we predict? So there's a lot unexplained. And the question is, where does that come from? And how important is that as a contributor to inequality? So lots of things we could do here, okay, let me just make a remark, which I referred to. I should stop pretty soon, right, Steve?
No, you have to.
He's trying to get out of work.
At 2 hours.
2 hours? Well, can get really boring, but at least I can slay the, these are facts, but they're facts that are very important. But let me just give you one thing which I think is extremely important in the American context, and it's true in other countries as well, that even though the price has increased, and what many people have looked at is the rate of return. Now, it depends on whether you call it a Mensa rate of return, whether you look at an internal rate of return, whether you actually compute a true rate of return, which is computed off the value function, including the option of going on to school. Nonetheless, whatever we do, prices have gone up, returns have gone up, and yet the supply response has been sluggish, and sometimes even perverse. So again, this is a graph that I think goes back to I don't know who it goes back to, I think Katz and Murphy, but the point is that what you found, and the whole literature has found, is that at a time around the 1980s, when the price of labor started going up, we saw that even though more people are going to college, the rate of growth of acceleration, the rate of growth of college attendance has actually slowed down. So what we've seen is a slowing down. It's like a point of inflection here where we move up and we move down here. It's still increasing, college high school supply, but it's much slower. And I'll show you something even more dramatic across the cohorts. So if you look, for example, at year of schooling by birth cohort, we see a very odd phenomenon that going back to the 1870s and going up to about 1950, 1960 in this period, what we saw is that every cohort of Americans has been getting more schooling than the previous cohort. That was the notion that you're always going to do better. Schooling expanded around 1940, these are the years of birth. So by 1940s, people will be in the mid-50s. More than half of American children had graduated high school. So what we see is that there's been a slowing down. Now, a recent start, very different pattern, by the way, between women and men. Women increasing, men increasing, but much at a slower rate, and a gap really emerging between the male and female college attendance. So this is, and notice, these people are born in 1950, so they're coming into the market for education, certainly those born by 1960, at a time when measured returns are going up. And even if you allow for some learning, you get a fairly sluggish response, and people are curious, what's going on? And the candidate stories are things like credit market failures, people can't borrow or lend against their future earnings, and changing demographic structure of the American family, that maybe the early years are less productive for certain groups of people. So what does it look like overall? Well, let me just show you these statistics. This is another way to look at it, but it's looking at final graduation levels, attainments, final attainment levels. And so No, sorry, it's actually looking at various attainment levels, not final. So this is the fraction of people graduating high school based on the year of birth. And what you can see is this same phenomenon we talked about. A real acceleration in high school dropout graduation rates until you get to about this period, and then basically an uneven pattern. College attendance is going up. Notice, if anything, in this period here, high school graduation rates are declining slightly. Very stark difference, though, between males and females. What you're finding is that, again, for the same cohort, 1950, 1960, a peak and then actually a decline, somewhat of a resurgence and then a decline, so that you're actually getting a period where you're below the rate at which people are graduating high school. Meanwhile, if you look at the college graduation rate, it's actually increasing, but it's going very slowly. And if you look at the same pattern for females, you're getting a very different pattern. Much less dropping out and much more of a steady, I would say virtually monotone growth pattern in terms of years of birth. So a gender difference that's real and is a topic of a lot of literature. So let me just to give a very simple decomposition, you can say how much of the growth in college graduation, if you just do a statistical decomposition, what's called a Laspeyres or Posh or Oaxaca blinder decomposition, whichever name you want to use, we can see that about 64% of the change in the college graduation rate would be attributive in this purely statistical decomposition to changing high school graduation rate for the first year, for the first half of the 20th century cohorts. And then afterwards is a slight negative decline, and with starkly different results for males and females. Okay. U.S. Educational attainment, well, this is much discussed. What's amazing, and this is going to show up repeatedly, if you look at Korea, of course, is a great success story. If you look at the change in educational attainment among, say, 55 to 64-year-olds in 2009, you see a dramatic growth. So that you basically get secondary school graduation rates close to 100% in Korea. The gaps, the sort of advantage the United States had at one time, has been competed away with very different, patterns, but still showing generally a substantial growth in most countries, and of course in Korea, dramatic, and also here, dramatic change in Ireland, where you actually saw a reduction in high school tuition payments, kind of forecasting what might happen in China if secondary school tuition got freed. And then this is the population with tertiary education. Again, Korea really stands out as a winner. And people are alarmed about this. This came up in the last presidential election. Gee, the country is going to hell. I think there was a book by Thomas Friedman saying this is what we used to be. We used to be on top, and now the Koreans are taking us apart, and some of the others, the Russians even. All kinds of quality questions, of course, but there's a real phenomenon here. Okay. So let me just talk about some dimensions. So I talked about the labor supply dimensions. And so the OECD actually gives you a very voluminous report. And I've taken quite a few figures from it. But let me just summarize the main. Unfortunately, they have to break down their data reporting by whether or not you have gross earnings or net earnings. Not all countries are reporting gross earnings. So you get a difference. But the key point here, whether it's gross or net, and for most countries, is that full-time worker inequality is actually greater when you include the part-time and full-time workers and workers including self-employment. The actual estimated Gini coefficients are smaller. It's not invariably true. This is probably more interpretable as a decomposition. It's telling you, let me just look at the gross earnings countries, maybe easier to see. What you see actually is a decomposition of the variance of annual earnings. You'll hear that there are a lot of reasons, violates the Pigou-Dalton criterion and so forth. But let me still do it anyway and break it down because it has a nice additive quality. We look at the variance of annual earnings between hourly wage rates, annual hours, and the covariance. Generally speaking, the covariances are positive, so they're reinforcing each other. But you can see, again, overall, now this is over these subsets of countries in the OECD, that a big chunk of variability is in hourly wages. earnings due to earnings variability due to hours is substantial, but for most countries, you're getting a substantial chunk of the variability is actually due to what we'd think of as a price of labor. And there's a covariance. So it looks like you might think of that positive covariance as coming from labor supply. You got to be careful in interpreting that, but nonetheless, it's consistent with like an upward sloping labor supply. And you get this for the other countries. Now, in terms of assortative mating, one of the biggest issues that's shown up here is that you're getting substantial differences in accounting. So again, these are crude statistical measures, but nonetheless, it's useful, nonetheless, to see what happens if you do it. So if you count individual earnings, okay, and so forth, and then you include, but again, inside households, you just look at the gross earnings, you're going to get a measure of inequality that's going to, in general, be substantially higher than once you adjust for earnings per worker and equivalent household earnings. So putting people into a household, the household by this measure is actually an equalizing institution, although the details remain. I mentioned how much women's employment had gone up and how much that was an equalizing factor in the OECD countries. This just shows it's not a uniform increase, but for most countries there's been a substantial employment increase for females. A few countries, the opposite in terms of male increase, but generally speaking, a substantial increase, although not uniform across all countries over this period. And that's been a factor generally towards producing income equality across households. And the greatest increase at the top of the distribution. And assortative mating, and it's measured different ways. You can measure by education, you can measure by earnings and so forth. But the general pattern has been that you're generally finding higher, if you look at the deciles of the husband and the deciles of the wife in families where there is marriage, you're getting more positive assorting, and that's a factor actually working towards higher income inequality across groups. That leads then to this whole concern about social stratification and is part of the story of Charles Murray's book last year about coming apart, and other books too about this growing class of highly educated professional people detaching from the larger society. But we also see another component which is troubling and which has huge implications for the next generation. Not only do you get this segregation at the top, well, people call it segregation. Segregation sounds too stark. It's not like going to some countries where you can see literally the rich living fenced off completely, although I guess there are parts of this country where that's true. But what we're also seeing is single-headed households. And now there's a real issue here. Let me just show you exactly. So notice the highest here on the list is Sweden. But most people know, well, Sweden has got a lot of cohabitation. And the question is, you know, what implication does that have? We know that there are actually a lot of people living together, partners living together. For all practical purposes, is that marriage? That's a subject very actively being studied now. It seems, if you look at child development, it's not quite the same, but it's far different from what exactly the statistic would mean in the next column over in the United States, which is typically where single-headed mothers are mostly disadvantaged mothers, low-educated mothers, and the most disadvantaged. So these statistics are not without controversy. But we can see that over many countries, a substantial growth in the proportion of children, the proportion of households that are single-headed. And in terms of child welfare, at least for some countries, that has substantial negative implications. Although the exact, the figure is crude. It just is aggregating two different styles. And as I say, two different types of family structures in terms of the resources of the children. This I already put up before. But I've given you some of the demography to suggest why these figures, these 22%, these two items together, are not trivial. Okay. Well, this is what we talked about already, about how there's an equalizing force from the transfers. Let me skip on. If we look at the income inequality, we can actually see, if we look at income source, you know, again, we have the problem Now, will we break things out even further? This is net income after transfer. So if you look at its various components, wage income is really a driving force across the OECD countries. This is now looking at equivalized households. So we're adjusting for economies of scale and so forth. But you're including taxes and transfers. And you can see that the income taxes have a powerful redistributive role. They actually lead to substantially lower income inequality. Social Security contributions, substantially lower. But income taxes are really the major driver of redistribution, and the major driver of an increase in inequality is growth in wages. Capital income plays a role. This is over the whole population. Within our 1/10 of 1%, this is a greater chunk of the total variation. And this more or less says what we talked about. It gives you a great detail. You can study this on your own, how redistributive different components are of income inequality across of transfers to reducing income inequality across countries. Okay, so now let me consider this question about whether or not a quantile is a proper measure of a skill. It's very common in literature to talk about. The problem with the quantile is that the labor force participation rate's changing. And as a result, if we look at the quantiles that are typically formed over the working population, and say we apply this to women, and we see that there's been a big growth in the population of female labor force participation, what we're really doing is we're changing the domain of definition. One percentile in 1980 is measuring a different skill level than one percentile in 2010. And that's an issue that has not received full attention. It's received attention, but it's an untrivial issue. So the notion that quantiles are skill prices, even though it's conventional in this measurement literature, is dangerous. Potentially dangerous. So here's exactly the labor force participation rate for the country. This is overall. We can see a substantial increase and then starting to get a decrease, but varying across demographic groups. And so we can see here, if I break it down by men and women, we can see a substantial increase in labor force participation across all male, female groups. Not so true for male groups, where things have actually fallen off a bit. So again, you're changing, you're comparing different populations. This I already told you about. Work declined more, so part of the employment reducing, producing greater inequality comes from the fact that we are losing at the bottom of the distribution a lot of male earners. Okay, well, we ask ourselves the following question. Let me just summarize this briefly. How much of a reduction do we get over time from various aspects of the transfer system? This is now back to the United States. We can see that over time, the reduction in inequality, so we can just decompose how much inequality in household income is due to transfers and taxes, how much. So what we've seen in the last 10 years or so, 2000 to 2008 or so in this period, is an uptick in terms of redistributive policy and then a falling away. And federal taxes have been fairly neutral, although it did actually play a role early on in reducing inequality. It's been pretty flat in the U.S. Okay, and this is how much redistribution comes by market income group. And what we see is that there's been a steady erosion, not dramatic, but steady erosion of transfers to the lowest quintile, and if anything, some growth to the highest quintile in terms of total transfers across the income distribution. And what we also see, though, and this is what many people get concerned about, is that elderly childless households are getting reduced resources, and households with children are getting fewer transfers in particular. So with an uptake here and then a decline. Now, so far we've looked at measures that have to do only with income, our wages. But we know that people are not completely interested just in their budget constraint. They may also be interested in what their net welfare is. And so under market structures where people can lend or borrow, say the complete market structure would be the ideal case for measuring this, and there's a whole set of intermediate market structures. Consumption inequality is closer to the ideal welfare inequality. But measuring consumption inequality is very difficult. So let me just give you a very brief tour of the literature. This goes back to Attanasio, Orazio Attanasio, and Steve Davis. Davis is here, actually, in this building. Working here at the Booth School. And so the analysis from the mid-90s was basically saying that consumption inequality follows income inequality pretty closely. So if you look at this pattern, you see a graph here of the change in men's log wage, the change in log consumption. The notion was, well, inequalities measuring, you know, consumption may diminish inequality. There's smoothing going on. You can draw down stocks of durables. You have lots of other mechanisms to smooth your consumption. But the fact of the matter is that income inequality and consumption inequality have matched each other pretty closely. But this issue is not settled by any means in the literature. And I'll just give you an alternative point of view. About 7 years ago now, Dirk Kruger and Perry, his co-author, looked at this question about the Gini index in and you can also look at variance of logs. It's telling you a similar story. If you look, for example, at consumption versus income inequality, then it looked like there had been an increase in income inequality, but not much in terms of consumption inequality. And so the argument was, no, consumption and income don't track each other. And in fact, this led to a very, very substantial literature. Here we can see it in other ways, measuring the 90-10 ratio, again, going back to quantiles. The 50-10 ratio also showing that. Oh, yes, please.
So when we discussed income inequality, you were talking about distinguishing between lifetime income and
yes.
At a point in time.
Correct.
And when you're looking at consumption income, are you talking about lifetime consumption?
Well, generally people, see, again, it depends on the market structure that's out there. But if you think about lifetime, suppose we imagine some version of the permanent income theory. That permanent income theory is actually going to be a good proxy for what your least expected future income will be. So it embodies much more of a life cycle notion. That's the notion. So yes, the question is now if I compare the ratios. See, what I'm missing, and what a lot of the literature is missing, is basically the distinction between ex ante and ex post. So we think that agents are forming ex ante expectations about future income. And those ex ante expectations then may be realized or not realized. There could be a lot of variation. But at least in terms of their consumption behavior, they're forming their expectations. So it includes their belief. It includes their expected future income in there. And then the actual realized income could be substantially different. And we think 30-40% of the variability in income is not fully anticipated. There really is updating. We are getting substantial variation. But the consumption measure gets closer to the concept of lifetime inequality. That's all. Some measure of lifetime welfare. I mean, think of the Hall type of permanent income theory. Hall-Bewley. Oh, T, yes.
Yes. Maybe you can think about, I think wealth is going to be much more, even more important than income.
Yes, if you can come.
You know about wealth inequality.
Well, I'll show you a couple of slides. Even in the U.S. context, not so good. But then the real question is, what do we mean by wealth? We'd want to include things like financial wealth as well as human capital and this other whole set of capabilities. And there are efforts to do that. You know, as you know, Jorgensen and others have actually tried to come up with full balance sheets for the wealth in the U.S. economy. But you're right. Each of these could be a measure. But there's also a sense, of potential. So that's where, we can't, I can tell you, you're very wealthy, you may be able to, you're going to get a lot of income in the future. But on the other hand, if the credit market is really bad, then for all practical purposes, I could starve to death, right? A billionaire could starve to death. If he gets his $1 billion the day after he dies of thirst in the desert because he can't borrow to get a bottle of water, then it's not clear what the proper measure of wealth would be. So it's not just intangible. But there is a literature. I'll show you some statistics here. But you're right. Wealth and consumption are both measures. So think of consumption, though, is clearly directly related to wealth, right? In the standard permanent income theory, the Fisher theory, you're basically going to be taking the annuity flow, or your expected annuity flow from your consumption, from your streams of income, both from wealth and labor income. So anyway, I'm not sure. I probably should stop pretty soon, actually. There are a whole set of questions about consumption measurement, which have been addressed by many scholars, and I can just talk about it. There are these different data sets that have come online recently, looking at the Nielsen home scan data. The PSID now has much richer consumption data than it used to have. And we have measures with food, non-durables, total consumption, and the like. So we can actually see some real progress that seems to be coming in the future, but less full agreement. There are also questions about what the appropriate deflator is, what the nature of underreporting is. I'm not going to be able to cover that in great detail. And there's a whole discussion about whether measurement error alters the inequality findings. And the answer generally is that it's important. And it does change somewhat our thinking about income inequality. But let me, I guess I feel I should. This is something that's non-trivial, though, and that is that one of the standard data sets that has been used in this literature, this goes from a paper by Adnazio, Eric Batista Sen, and Hideki Ichimura, looking at the difference about how the CEX, which is the standard consumer survey used, how well it tracks the components in the national income and product accounts. And if anything, the latest findings have suggested they do very badly. So if I look at the diaries, I'm getting a huge discrepancy between the discrepancy at the CEX and from this other product and income accounts, which leads some people to be quite concerned about what this is all about. And so we can actually see the gap, this ratio here. The numbers should all be one here. And you can see they're not. And so that's a huge issue. And here's even the difference now, more recent studies, Meyer and Sullivan, and also Adnazio and Battistin have shown huge differences between whether or not you interview people about the expenditure versus whether or not you collect diaries, where you actually literally keep a diary. And again, there's an ongoing literature on that. So what am I saying? Well, there are a lot of problems. Let me just leave it with the fact that it's heavily debated in the literature about the importance of this. I should probably, this is the diary data, and this is the difference. So there are some substantial differences across these incomes. But more recently, this paper by Atanasio, Hurst, and Pistifari, maybe you'd like to talk about this, Sarah? No? Has gone some way towards reconciling these different literatures, right? There are two or three different criteria. There's a paper by Blundell, Pistifari, and Preston. I think it's in the Quarterly Journal of Economics, where they actually are using an imputation procedure, going back to the fact that the PSID data set only had food expenditure. And then the question is, you can invert the Engel curve to go from the food to the actual consumption. And then you can try other procedures, other imputation procedures. And what you see is that you're starting to get some reconciliation across the measures, at least in terms of time series behavior and so forth. So obviously, food consumption is a small component. But then you can actually get imputations which are starting to line up. And so we're starting to get some agreement. And I think the agreement would be that you're now finding, indeed, some increase in consumption inequality, which actually was not what was coming out of the mid-2000s literature, but it's now starting. But let me just leave that. Sarah can answer all questions on that at the break. How's that?
Can I ask something?
Yes, absolutely.
Is it more appropriate to talk about expenditure inequality rather than consumption inequality? Because it might be the case that two different families might be spending the same amount of money on consumption, then those two families wouldn't be unequal in terms of our measures, but still they might be consuming pretty different goods. One family might be consuming organic food, the other family could be just eating chips, crisps, whatever.
Right. Well, I mean, you could start taking a position which is getting closer to the capability position, that it's not just dollars spent. it's much more what you spend it on and how that enhances your larger life opportunities. I think that's what you're getting at. And that's the current direction of measurement in the, but it isn't much in the literature yet, simply because it's very difficult to incorporate. So what I think you're suggesting is that one household is spending its money foolishly. It's actually producing probably poor health. It's maybe eating food that actually will undermine its long-term health. And so if you were to...
Concerning the U.S. and Mexico.
Yeah, exactly. So again, but you could actually then, that takes us closer to the measurement of long-term health. So if you think about, so some recent work by Galama and others, and Gabriella working with Galama, looking at the effect that various consumption patterns could itself have the consequence of producing substantial lower levels of life expectancy. Okay, let's just take that. So now the proper measure is not your expenditure today, exactly, I agree, but it would be some measure of your expected lifetime welfare, which you could extract. But that would require the ingredient of knowing how those consumption expenditures and other expenditures translate into enhanced future resources, including life expectancy, okay? That's what's required. So a full capital theoretic notation would actually have then the valuation function. But at some point, it could be the case that this individual may like to drink. And so that individual may just simply choose rationally, or at least think they're choosing rationally, to kill themselves, but they love vodka. And so they're shortening their lives by 10 years, but they certainly like those shortened 10 years a lot more than if they had been on the wagon. And then you get to a question where you're saying, okay, maybe they have the wrong preferences, which gets into a whole set of other questions, which Steve will address shortly. No, but it's a non-trivial question. There's no obvious answer to that question. But the first part is, if we agree on like a standard set of preferences, we can then ask, what is enhancing the stocks of health? And then that stock of health, all of that would actually feed into the valuation function. So the real measure of welfare, to go back to what T was saying and what you were saying too, was basically, yeah, we'd like to think about solving the lifetime evaluation problem, write down the value functions as perceived by the agent, what their expected lifetime wealth would be, and how that increments over the lifetime, okay? Including the production of wealth. Yes?
So the idea with that discrepancy, if it's not just measurement error, between consumption and income inequality, that people with high incomes aren't spending all their money, or is it more that people with low incomes take on a lot?
Well, it's not so much debt. I mean, that's another issue. It's about whether or not people are, there's a whole issue discussion about student loans that show up in terms of the discussion of why the U.S. Has been slow to respond to increased prices of skills. But I think here the notion was really kind of wise versus unwise consumption and what the capital value would be of current consumption. So literally current consumption would feed in to future wealth and health, right, in terms of earnings. So I literally, if I become a diabetic, I would lose my capacity to work as effectively. I might take lower wages. I'd certainly shorten my life expectancy. And that would lead to a whole set of other choices, which would limit my options in the future. I think that's what people were talking about more than, but debt could be another component of it. You could simply say, but then you get to the question about whether these are wise choices or whether they are, quote, informed choices, or whether or not they are uninformed choices. And that gets a little too much, well, it gets in the direction of saying what should be the prescription for the proper life. And that becomes more controversial, right? You say, this is foolish. You shouldn't drink vodka. It's just bad for you. I don't know, I might like vodka. I might choose to shorten my life by drinking massive quantities, or smoking, or doing a lot of other things. That gets to a question about whether or not, what set of preferences should govern the choices that individuals make, okay? And should we shape those choices? So that's a different set of questions. You know, I'm using the wrong preferences. People claim that's going on. And it could be for one of two reasons. One is this lack of information. And a second is that it's willful choice. And it's very difficult looking at the data we have now on choice behavior to infer which of those two it is. There could be ex post regret, but that could simply be lack of information. I didn't know I was going to shorten my life after drinking so many bottles of vodka, but I would do it all over again if I had the same information as I did, say, at age 20. But at age 70, I may say, no, I'm not really going to do that. I wish I hadn't done that. I don't know if that answers your question.
Oh, a little bit. I was also wondering, is it because people with more incomes aren't spending a big chunk of that income?
The reason for the change in the consumption
law. Yeah, so it looked like you're showing us.
But you're saying capital saving. You're saying. Right. You could say part of that has to do with smoothing. I mean, one of the motives for actually saving, for accumulating, not spending all your money, is to smooth out consumption, income shocks. So that would be like, you know, a buffer stock. You'd hold a stock of savings against a rainy day. So that would be one component. But I thought you were making a welfare judgment that came out of it. Sure, there are many reasons for saving, right? I mean, basically, if I get a very high income now and I expect to get a low income in the future, I would expect I'd want to redistribute that resource over more periods of life. It's not feast or famine, right?
I guess this goes back to the question that I asked. So how can we reconcile the fact that there is higher income inequality than consumption inequality? So what's happening?
Well, wait, the measure of income that I was giving was kind of the current cross-section inequality. Mm-hmm. And the way I would reconcile it would again be to appeal to a permanent income type of theory. Okay. So what's happening is today I have an income flow. But what's happening is that I expect the income flow to have some components that are stochastic. Now as I realize those, my permanent income is very different from my measured income. These fluctuations I'm smoothing out by saving. So I'm building up an asset stock. So if you go back to the classical permanent income theory of Friedman, actually, that was exactly the motivating force. The permanent income was actually some long-term average. So even my five-year averages, or the ones that Piketty and Saez were using, aren't really capturing the full lifetime inequality, simply because there's this whole expected future life cycle profile of shocks and realizations that I'm going to get. So that's why the difference between the two, right? Well, you could still see a difference in the variability, because what's happening with consumption is consumption is basically, we think, a forward-looking measure. So what you're doing is you're forming an expectation over the future income. The actual shocks could be very different in terms of lifetime income. So you expect to see more variability, right? Because you're smoothing those shocks by these consumption profile. That's the idea. And that gets to the point, which I haven't developed, and this literature doesn't develop that well, which is ex ante versus ex post. Literally, I have then the revelation of information. And a non-trivial question is, how much of income variability is uncertain at a point in time? We think differently from a point of view of making judgments about inequality. If our life is nasty, brutish, short, and a lot of uncertainty, we somehow think that's different. If there's a lot of volatility, if it's nasty, brutish, and uncertain, maybe being nasty, brutish, and certain is better from a pure risk aversion at the same mean, right? Because now you simply can't protect yourself. You don't know what you're going to do tomorrow. So there really are welfare consequences, and we can talk about it, although I don't have, not today and not in this lecture, but there is a discussion in the literature asking what the welfare consequences are. That comes from uncertainty. But the problem is, of course, coming up with what's the measure of uncertainty. And the problem is solved typically in the literature by writing down some statistical decomposition and then asking, well, okay, I have a certain amount of income today. I predicted this certain amount of income based on some forecast rule, and the innovation is uncertainty. The problem with that is that's really not probably what the uncertainty is. There could be components of that shock arrived at through the statistical decomposition that agents would know. And so the way that people actually sort that out in the literature, a more careful way, is not just to write a statistical decomposition, but to ask, well, people will react differently to a component of income that they know than from a component of income that's unanticipated, that they didn't know. And so you can actually see consumption revisions. So in the permanent income theory I was talking about before, an expected future shock, if I didn't observe it because my data were no good, but the agents had it, when that shock arrives, it's not going to have much of an effect, right? I already anticipated it. On the other hand, if it really is unanticipated, I'm going to see a revision of my permanent income theory. And so that's the way the literature works, is asking whether or not events in the future are anticipated in terms of the present today. So statistically, what I could do is ask the following question. Do the innovations that occur in future income, how many of those innovations affect my current choices? Completely unanticipated, then they wouldn't, right? The mean might, but not the actual shock itself. So that's the way people would go about looking at these two different components. But certainly true that the welfare consequence of uncertainty is very different from the welfare consequence of the same stream perfectly anticipated. Friedman's original theory was basically the whole streams were perfectly anticipated. That was his theory. It's a perfect certain model. He had some uncertainty tacked on at the end, but and there you get the pure version that literally you get a life cycle profile that may have this big hump of earnings and then decline, but people would just average that out and come up with the annuity value of that. The modern update is you're forming an expectation of the future lifetime income, and each period by period, you're updating your information. And so it's a moving target. It's not the perfectly certain static target that Friedman was talking about, okay? All right. Let me make one remark that I think is important. There's a big debate about what not only the variance is, but actually the level of well-being at the bottom. What we've actually seen, well, let me skip one. Yes, here. This is a better figure for my point. This is recent work by Meyer and Sullivan. Meyer's here at the University of Chicago. And what you actually see is, except I can't see it, is the difference between at the 10th percentile and at the median of the distribution, what is going on in terms of after-tax income and in terms of consumption. And so again, if we start looking at consumption, we can see substantial improvements. Well, let me put it this way. Maybe I shouldn't get into the details of this because actually I really am running out of time. Let me just maybe show you this figure. This is consumption and income inequality, and this is now over the period of the Great Recession. So you can see what's happening is that by this measure, where they're actually including a whole set of after-tax money income, including the taxes and transfers, not just looking at the CPS raw earnings data, but actually looking at transfers, that adjusted consumption inequality really hasn't increased all that much over this period of the downturn. So this is where these adjustments play a huge role. This is adjusting not only for the deflator, but it's also adjusting for things like transfers, food stamps, and housing. So that the question is whether or not people are worse off today at the bottom is an open question. And then Hausman has this paper on Walmart showing a substantial benefit. So here's the dramatic chart that I think is what I was looking for here. If you look, for example, at measures of income, real changes in income and consumption, you can actually see this looks like a very bad story in terms of income for the bottom 10 percentile or bottom 5 percentile. But if you look at consumption, it's not so bad at all. And so in that sense, that's getting not just to the smoothing question, it's also getting to the tax transfer policy. So I will leave. There's another whole paper, which I can't cover, unfortunately, by Burkhauser, Larimore, and Simon, where they talk about the difference. I gave you studies by Piketty and Saez that are very influential, properly so. But there's a difference. Piketty and Saez are looking at tax reporting units. And tax reporting units are not the same as households. And you get a very different perspective on inequality if you use these two different measures. And this paper goes through that. So here's the key point. The distinction between tax units and households is not trivial, even though they're used interchangeably. Because the tax units are basically people who file. And a household has this kind of economic functioning and with redistribution going on within it. And you get a different pattern. But let me skip past that. Here's the wealth inequality. Although the statistics here are far from ideal, you're finding substantial differences in median wealth holding over time and net worth. And so you're getting real, you know, the very bottom people not getting very much net worth, very high levels of net worth at the top 20% of the distribution and so forth. So let me. And then there are international comparisons, but I think in the sake of brevity, I should do this. So the question becomes, and this is going to start getting close to what you're talking about, right? I really do believe I should stop by 11, right? That's already a long time talking. I know the listening to lists of facts can't be that, but we're coming back to these facts. So what's the role of the family? Family income has an ambiguous role. This kind of graph shows up all over. And this is going to be a recurrent theme through the lectures. So here, for example, is the question of who goes to college. We saw there were substantial differences. Graphs like this have been put up for the last 70, 80 years, as soon as income data were available. And you can literally see that high-income families are much more likely to be sending their kids to school, go to attend college, low-income families. What is it about family income that's driving these graphs? What does family income measure? And what is it capturing? I would just point out that once you condition on family income, and once you condition on the ability of children applying to school, family income plays almost no role in accounting for differences across different groups in terms of going to college and not. It's considerably diminished. So in other words, the ability difference of the child is highly correlated with the family income difference. That's a fact. The question is, what does that fact mean and how do we interpret it? But to come back later, so here's an example of how schooling depends on family income and so forth. And then when we get to family environments more generally, we say, look, this has gone on now, this phenomenon. I showed you this run-up across many countries in the world of single family. Now we get one manifestation of single-parent families. If you look at, for example, 1940, about 5%, a little less than 5% of all kids of births were to unmarried women, and now in the U.S. it's over 40%. So you're getting a very fundamentally different pattern. And it varies. One of the greatest patterns, if you look, for example, non-Hispanic parents, white non-Hispanic parents, over this period, 75 to 2010, you'll see that, again, there's a very substantial, there's a slightly different statistic. This isn't birth. This is children under 18 living in a single-parent family. But what you see is a tremendous run-up, and where the run-up is greatest is in this category of never-married single mothers. And in the United States, anyway, that's a category, generally, of great disadvantage for the child. It varies across different demographic groups. Black families, higher absolute levels, but a pattern the same, that the never married singles are really the big part of the story of the growth in the last 30, 35 years. And the same thing is true for Hispanic parents. Now, you are going to talk about intergenerational transmission, right? Today. No, don't worry. I'm going to stop very short. What's that?
I'll talk about it
Wednesday. Okay, well, this is just another dimension of inequality. And the so-called Gatsby curve, which I'm going to talk more about this afternoon so I can hold my fire, is basically just running this regression of the income of a child in generation G plus one on the income of the parent. And, you know, there are all kinds of statistical issues that the literature has addressed. Namely, you want to make sure that the income measures are long-term income measures instead of short-term fluctuations. But you also want to try to measure roughly the same age of the parent and the child so that you're getting roughly the same stage in the life cycle. And there's a very large empirical literature showing how much these things matter in terms of affecting. But the general drift is basically the income of the child progressed on the income of the family. This is the so-called intergenerational income elasticity. These are log income measures, that beta would be the income elasticity. And so there are these statistical questions that arise. And this is just an example taken from a paper by Mazumdar, how much bias there is in the beta. So there was an idea out there that in the United States, the society was very fluid, that if your income of your father was such and such, your own income wasn't that much correlated. However, that was based on using annual earnings. And if we actually use longer and longer averages, of course, because again, it's long-term income that matters. We have transitory fluctuations that could reduce down, just a standard measurement error formula bias would bias the beta downward. And that's exactly what you find happening. So longer the average, remember this is saying the longer term average, then the less bias there is. And the bias then means that what you're getting is a much greater evidence for high beta. So in the United States, that is around 0.45 to 0.5. I'll show you. These are figures. Actually, these are figures from one of many surveys by Ajanti et al. Some 7 years ago, but showing that this elasticity, again, in logs of fathers on sons, sons on fathers' income, by 0.07 for Denmark. The Nordic countries generally pretty low, although Sweden getting up there. The United States getting as high as 0.5. Now it's estimated to be more like 0.45. And there are a lot of different statistical issues. These are based on long-term averages, though. And you can see that this suggests a very substantial role of the father's income in shaping the son's outcome. And you get somewhat weaker relationships for mothers and daughters, although that's not an obvious pairing. It should be family income and family on child outcomes. But for obvious reasons that historically a lot of women weren't working, there's a lot of variability in the female income measure, so I won't go through it. And there's a survey paper by Solon. And again, the numbers aren't always in uniform agreement, for example. But again, the general pattern tends to be the British data tend to show high intergenerational elasticity, so these are higher than what I showed before. The U.S. statistics are, these are South African surveys. I don't know if there's, there is a U.S. statistic, but the U.S. statistic is high. And there's a recent summary that I know that Steve is covering by Blandin, so I'll just skip over that. This is another dimension of this, though, how highly correlated the education is of the child with the education of the parent. And you can see in countries like Peru and Ecuador, a lot of the Latin American countries, the educational attainment correlations are extremely high. And again, when you get down to many of the Northern European countries, especially the Nordic countries, the correlations tend to be low. And and again, this has a sampling of less developed countries as well as Western European countries. So we get a very pronounced a general pattern that the Nordic countries with their greater redistributional resources, subsidies for schooling and the like, typically have weaker correlations. Although even in those countries, you'll notice, the correlation is far from zero. So there's a strong correlation between the education of the father and the education of the child. Let me talk very briefly about health inequality, because I am really out of time. This is well documented in the U.S. And if you look at this, you see substantial differences in measures of health, different measures of health. So these are estimated self-reports of fair and poor health. And again, what you're finding is that as you go down, to higher and higher levels of family income, the measures of ill health, so it's a measure of ill health, decline. So there are substantial income gradients that are much remarked. And of course, in the United States, by race plays a huge role, and by education, educational attainment, again, huge role with substantial racial differences, and high school Hispanics with less than high school degree having a very substantial measures of ill health, less than very good health. So we see gender, we see differences by race. What's interesting is the question is, how does health inequality relate to income? And this is a So there is a relationship between life expectancy and GDP per capita, with, of course, whole issues of causality going either way. Mortality, we get very substantial differences in infant mortality, more in the South and poorer areas of the country. Infant mortality, you can see, this is a component that's missing, in terms of frequently missing. Here's low birth weight. Again, India is off the chart. In terms of low birth weight prevalence. Obesity issues, non-trivial, again, by income. Again, if you look at international obesity comparisons, I'm told clear this single measure is by itself that useful. But certainly the United States wins the prize at least through 2009. And these are the obesity rates internationally. Diabetes, huge race and differences, ethnic differences, and international comparisons. Again, large arrays of these factors. So this is the standard graph from a book by Pickett and Wilson, Wilkinson, looking at income per more controversial because the graph's all over the place, and you do some sensitivity analysis, you'll see the main evidence for this, by the way, we'll come back to health a little bit this afternoon, is the so-called Whitehall study that was suggesting that status within the given group by itself is a contributor to mortality. People claim to adjust for things like income and other influences and access to health care. This is all British data. And the claim is that these people all are, at least they've adjusted for the fact, but for the fact that there might be differences in access to health care. And you do find that the relative status of individuals seems to be, at least the claim is a major factor for producing differences in health. Let me skip this. And let me just conclude with this statistic about developing countries. So again, when we were in China last month, the issue about the Chinese inequality was a huge issue on the agenda. Everybody was complaining, and there's no question. But on the other hand, if you look at the per capita And so you can see different patterns in different regions, but far East Asia has been the major story. Let me end with a statement from Rosenzweig, Mark Rosenzweig, who's at Yale. It's an interesting study, and it's not even the main point of the study, but it's a table from the study. He's looking at international migration and so forth. He looks at a number of countries, and he's asking the question, okay, look, we find that there's a Mensa return to schooling. But if we look at inequality across countries, a big chunk of the inequality is not so much the rate of return to schooling. When I run a regression with an intercept, schooling, and the coefficient on schooling, you get the so-called Mensa coefficient, the coefficient on schooling. So he's actually able to compute somebody with zero schooling. So there are all kinds of problems with interpreting really the intercept is zero schooling, but let's say at a very low level of schooling. What he's finding is that the huge contributing factor to inequality across countries is not so much the return to schooling. It's a factor. And the schooling level plays a big role, but a big chunk of it has to do with the intercept. And what has to do with the intercept has to do a lot with institutions. It has a lot to do with the way markets are functioning or not functioning in those markets. So he wants to suggest, yes, schooling is very important, but at the same time, if you look at the ratio, the highest to the lowest, you're getting a huge ratio. The Mensa coefficient, you're getting 11 to 1 variation, so that's not trivial. The interquartile range is 1.7, but the skill price, the base skill price is different. And that has to do with things like capital accumulation. It has to do with things like the institutions and level of regulation and the like. So even though I have a somewhat of a bias towards labor economics and individual skills and capabilities, it's important to keep in mind that a major factor in producing inequality, especially global inequality, is not just educational differences, but it has something to do with differences of the way society's organized and the level of capital stock. So I think I've spent way too much time on facts. There's a lot of variation in facts, but these facts you have to study, and you can go through it. So I guess at this point I should ask, are there any questions? Yes, people are probably numb at this point saying, let's get on with this, and I don't blame you. But we're gonna come back to these facts, at least I'm gonna come back to them, some of them this afternoon, with some models, with trying to understand it. So I put out a lot of different things here on the table. But I think the important ideas are out now, and namely, yeah, skills play a huge difference. But so far, if we ask how do we explain total amount of variability in society, it's not just skills. It's not just pure uncertainty either. It's truly an open question. Go ahead. Yes.
Yeah. Related to that.
there's more research also talking about variation in the firm component of inequality.
Yeah, that would be partly what's in Rosenzweig's intercepts here. Productivity of firms across, which partly is due to the regulatory environment, partly due to the level of capital accumulation, and that itself could be a function of things like the political economy as well as the functioning of markets. Yeah. To the best of my knowledge, and correct me if I'm wrong, I'm sure there's a lot of knowledge here in this room that I lack, so please feel free to correct anything I say. To the best of my knowledge, nobody has even done this kind of simple calculation. I mean, you could put in things like measures of the capital stock. We know in terms of the growth, the inter-country growth regressions, of which Steve is a big fan and we'll talk further about. But I'm just talking about levels of achievement. If we ask, I mean, the trouble is the measures of capital are very strange and very difficult. If you were to ask how much of the variability across, in principle, it's in Rosenzweig's table. And so, but what you're going to find is that a fairly small fraction of the total variance in wages across these different countries has to do with variance in the schooling coefficient and in terms of income, I mean, in terms of educational variance. It's a factor. It's an important factor. But it's by no means the whole story. But I honestly don't know if somebody has parsed it out. You could see how to do it, right? You estimate production functions. I mean, I think the ingredients are there. And maybe it's somebody's done it, and I just don't know it. It's a great project to do, to say, OK, I have measures of capital stock. I want to know how much of the capital stock is producing things in wages. It's also producing things like capital income. It's also producing a whole set of others, returns, which would be the fully inclusive measure. So how much of all aggregate wages is actually, on how much aggregate welfare, sorry, variation is actually due to things like capital stock and to regulatory factors? And the answer is we don't know. If you ask Acemoglu and Robinson today, they would say a lot of it has to do with whether or not you adopted a British development style, a British governmental economic governance style or political governance style, British style, I should say. And but others would hotly dispute that return. They don't come up with a quantitative assessment either, do they? Literally saying how much. That's what's short. I mean, people do this. And I've given you more numbers than you probably ever wanted to see. But the fact of the matter is that there's still a shortage out there in terms of asking exactly what they are. I put up one table provocatively because most people, I surprised many people by saying that the variance in wages explained by IQ is about 4 to 5%. Most people think it's like 50%, right? Smart people get higher wages, but they don't. A lot of other factors out there, they get higher wages on average. So you don't want to confuse a high T statistic, a low P value, with a real measure of what's variance explained. And I don't think we can just all appeal to measurement error, although sure, there's a lot of it. It's an open question, but it affects everything. It affects everything to know exactly what the relative proportions are. So what we really want to do is draft you all to a large project to work on doing this welfare, to do this inequality accounting. But it has multiple ramifications. And the ramifications would be, well, okay, we're looking then at prices. What are the determinants of prices? What are the determinants of the quantities? And what's the relationship in the economic system? And that's an open question. So, and I really don't know. Maybe somebody has an opinion. No opinions. But I don't think anybody else knows either. So that's what I really want to say. I think a lot of this is open question. So Steve, you want to take over? 15-minute break. So we go to 12:30, is that it?
No, we are.
No, I thought it was 12:30 to 1:30. I have it scheduled saying that.
We were going to stop at 12. But
God, I'm sorry. I thought we had...
No, it's fine. The point is not to let the artificial constraints...
So the format of this first lecture is not conducive to a lot of questions. Hey, what's wrong with line 4 of table 6? I mean, every one of these things has some pretty vague stuff. What did I use as the measure of household income? Exactly what was the universe of evaluation? I started going through it, but I promise you, in every one of these instances, you could do a lot more than what I did here. But at least I hope the general contour is there. the general, and where at least the questions are. So a lot more to come, and I'm going to talk a lot more about developing these capabilities and the so-called Gatsby curve. So I'm going to talk about intergenerational transmission of various kinds of capabilities. So I'll develop the first theme I started much further. But no questions? Yes.
Well, your benchmark value equality accounting, but for the channels, actually, they're not mutually exclusive.
No.
So how do you solve this problem?
Well, I mean, in principle, you can go back to, I guess, first causes, if you want to use that term. I mean, literally, most of these inequality decompositions, a lot of these, are going to be basically just taking a, just applying a standard differential calculus or taking finite changes and saying, here's the difference in one number, here's the difference in another number, and here are the different contributing factors. And then literally reporting a coefficient associated with a decomposition of that type. That is far from any kind of causal explanation. I hinted at a causal explanation when I started running regressions on wages and earnings and hours on things like cognition and on non-cognitive abilities and on experience and on education. But even there, that's incomplete. Why is it incomplete? Well, just think about education by itself. Why do people get education? In a fully functioning labor market, you would expect then that people who get higher returns might get higher level of education. So the education is far from exogenous. And on top of that, the level of cognitive ability would also, and as we're going to see, levels of cognitive ability are not exogenously given. There's an endogeneity. You can't improve the level of cognition through child investment, through self-investment. And each of these factors will then be itself a factor. Then you get to kind of a world where, you know, I don't want to suggest something hopelessly complex, but there are feedback processes. In fact, that's going to be a theme of this, of a lot of the lectures about how the feedback processes work. So every cause in a particular decomposition, every particular, you know, statistical decomposition could itself be a function of some deeper causes and even some of the very same factors that I'm treating as part of the decomposition. I mean, let's think about the production function for labor. Make it simple. Capital and labor. Both of those are choice variables, we think, in certain settings. And we ask, well, why is it that I chose a certain amount of capital? Why is it I chose a certain amount of labor? Only under very special circumstances, which Klein talked about, many have talked about Cobb-Douglas type assumptions, can you come by with things like shares as giving you some statistically desirable property for asking what is the causal effect of things like capital and labor on producing output or output growth. So yes, every one of these. But the danger, though, and the fact the way the literature is proceeded precisely because of your concern, is you get to a very, very micro orientation. So you lose yourself in the details, which is important. Right? It's important to get into the details. But it's also important, I think, to come back and ask, well, how much of overall inequality is due to A, B, and C by these decomposition measures? But to my knowledge, still, we probably should have had a lecture on statistical decomposition. I don't think Foster is talking about that, is he? Yeah. I mean, there are ways to do this. There are ways to essentially model how each of these components got to. But that would mean then you take an economic model for each of those inputs and for each of the prices. Okay, so the price of labor is not just something given to you. I guess in subsistence economies with unlimited supplies of labor, the price of labor might be exogenous. But in fact, the structure is going to be more likely that that's going to be an equilibrium phenomena depending on the level of capital stock and the level of the educational stock. And that makes a big difference, actually, in determining how much of what quote the cause is. So cause as a system is a notion here that really has to be settled, I think, by appealing to some mechanisms. And that's really partly what I'm going to talk about, but only within a small, very narrow piece, really, of everything I talked about this morning. But we have nobody talking about these decompositions? Yeah, too bad.
One more thing that
sure.
Didn't seem was in here.
Yeah, well, there's a lot not in here, but go ahead, yes.
This is a big one. We're talking about purchasing power in terms of income. We're talking about what people actually consume, but we're not talking about what they give up in order to earn that purchasing power.
Well, you would in the models of education, like the opportunity cost.
I guess the basic example I would give is it's one thing to earn $10,000 a year as a professor and another thing to earn it as a worker on an oil rig. So maybe there's some element of equalizing differences that we're leaving out. I was wondering if that will be in a later lecture or...
Well, no. I mean, what you're getting at is the non-pecuniary components of compensation. And that is a literature that actually is on what's called hedonics, where people are trying to value how much you're willing to pay, say, to avoid working on an oil rig, which can be quite effortful and potentially dangerous. And so you actually see estimates in the literature of talking about what the wage premium is for taking riskier jobs. The education case is even simpler, though. Namely, if I take the life cycle perspective and I write down the valuation functions, what I'm going to do is I'm going to say, okay, here's the life cycle benefit, but up front I pay the cost, and then I'm going to see how much production I get. And so then I would actually compute the rate of return as the increment to the valuation function, net of costs. They would include cost in the full value function associated with education. So I could write down the value function for a given level of education, the value function for another level of education, and the rate of return, holding everything else the same, would be the normalized by the baseline level value function change in the value function. And that would include all the components that led to the cost. So absolutely. That's why, in the end, the correct measure is going to be a measure that's like the valuation function, which would give you like the permanent income, the total wealth associated with a lifetime program, and updated by the amount of information. So, for sure. Now, you ask, how important is that empirically? Well, some people have actually estimated that, and there is substantial evidence that there are compensating premium in risky occupations, for example. And you can come up with an idea. Now, how do you want to translate that into an overall measure of welfare? Because I don't think you want to just stock with the money income. You want to look at what the net welfare is. So you'd want to include, again, the measure of welfare, including the consumption evaluation, the utility evaluation. Although if Sen were here, he would not be happy with the utility evaluation. He would want to have the set of capabilities that you could come up with. So it would be a larger set of states that I would consider. But to a first round, the kind of conventional answer is going to be to look at some welfare evaluation. And what Sen would do is say, no, I don't want to just stop there. I want to consider what your potential is. I want to consider what your total outcomes could be, what your total valuations might be. So what Sen's worried about is that you might get used. Suppose you're a poor person. You start out life in poverty. Then the value to you of money when you're 40 years old, if you spent the first 40 years in poverty, could be quite a bit lower. And so the question is, should you use the parameters, the preference parameters that were shaped by life experiences to value a bundle? That's what Sen's trying to avoid. He already wants to put out. But the trouble is then in place of a number, he has a set. And now we have a problem that the sets may contain each other, but generally we won't. So you get partial orders and you don't get a very complete. But you can take each of these questions further. I'm not trying, but you understand what I'm saying. That yes, there is a large literature. Yes. What's the best reference in terms of just equalizing differentials estimates? There's a huge, huge literature, but a recent evidence. I mean, Greenstone and Ashenfelder have what's that?
Particularly in terms of how it affects inequality measurement. Of course, there's a literature that explains it, but.
Yeah. Well, there's some narrow aspects. For example, there were papers that were done getting closer to my transfers where people were looking at how much inequality was changed by including extra dimensions of compensation, for example. And so, for example, health insurance. And so if you include health insurance coverage, that actually expands the level of inequality because there's a lot of correlation between the level of income and the amount of health insurance coverage that you have. It's generally thought to be the case that more educated, except for the risk in participating in financial markets and the risk of going to prison, there would be a generally lower risk of the kind you're describing associated with an oil rig worker with higher income education, with higher educated, higher income individuals. And as a result, the pattern seemed, see, the trouble with the equalizing differentials model, even though it goes back to Adam Smith, so you should, in these halls, we should never say there's a problem with it, but still a problem, is that people are heterogeneous. And what we really see is it's not like we're all along a single utility curve and I'm going to get a compensation. Generally speaking, and for tax purposes and for number of purposes, people are going to spend their money on amenities that are favorable. So you're going to find that a lot of non-market components that we're going to favor the higher measured income people. So my conjecture is if you include all this bundled together, you're getting much level higher levels of inequality. Parts of it are quantified, not the full bundle, not to my knowledge, unless somebody knows. Does anybody?
Hammermish is a paper quantifying some aspects.
Hammermish does, yeah. But you mean beauty? Beauty, you mean, or what? You mean his work on beauty?
Non-pecuniary inequality, I think that's the...
Yeah, I mean, he was talking about beauty, right? He was talking to people who were... So there was a non... He was actually coming up with a pecuniary component. But which Hammermish paper are you talking about? I don't know that which. Yeah, what does he do in the dimensions?
He's looking at a set of workers and looking at health insurance or pension schemes and all those things.
Oh, right. No, that's what I was saying earlier. I mean, there's a study done by the BLS in the mid '90s. I don't know the particular Hammermish paper where they're asking what's the contribution of fringe benefits to overall. But that's slightly different. Some of the fringe benefits, what he's talking about is the intrinsic job risk. So I start working an oil rig off the Gulf of Mexico, in the middle of Gulf of Mexico, and the part of the risk is the rig may blow up, the hurricane may sweep me off, et cetera, et cetera. And that's a risk which lowers my expected utility. And there are papers that try to measure that using the so-called hedonic method. You've all seen hedonic methods. But again, the issue is you want to be really careful in understanding the sorting of which individuals go into which tasks. Generally speaking, the people working on oil rigs are not your little old ladies from Pasadena who are very, very risk averse. They're kind of, many of them are escaped criminals, I'm told, trying to get anonymous. So what I'm saying is there's a lot of heterogeneity, and so the premium actually paid could be quite a bit lower. There's a famous example when the skyscrapers were built in New York City in the 1930s or 20s. There was an Indian tribe from upstate New York. Maybe you know this tribe. The Mohawks. They were the ones who were, they had no fear of heights, right? I mean, apparently not. They even enjoyed it. And so instead of getting this big premium, this equalizing differentials, this seemed to be a bonus on the job to walk along a girder, which would scare the hell out of most people. The Mohawks seemed to enjoy it, right? So they didn't get such high wages, did they?
I don't think so.
Right, that was frequently remarked. Most people wouldn't touch the job, but the Mohawks liked it, so who knows?
The fathers brought their sons in, and it was kind of a closed industry.
Oh, so it was a union shop too?
Well, it was an Indian tribe shop.
But
it was effectively the same thing.
Okay, very good. But that's the kind of sorting that goes on, which makes it very difficult. Because you have a lower risk aversion, then you're not going to take so much compensation. And naturally speaking, unless you have complete restriction, you're going to basically have the more risk averse people not going into walking on girders in New York City in 1920. And that's the kind of sorting. But that's what the hedonic literature does. You've all seen versions of the hedonic literature, right? But there are more theoretical papers than there are empirical papers in the literature. And the most recent one, I think, is Greenstone and Ashenfelder, right? An auto risk, 2004 Journal of Political Economy. And there are various papers in environmental engineering, environmental economics, looking at different types of environmental risks. You know, how much less you're willing to pay for a house if it has radon. Presumably you should be willing to pay a lot less, but so forth. But you do find various risks. Risk associated with earthquakes, and of course those typically are underappreciated. Each one of these has a small. You could go on for hours, and I have, so I should stop. Yes. Yeah, we should stop for a while, and then, but we'll pick up with Durloff and the Mohawks.